know about relationships, but you're wrong. Listen, there's no magic bullet. I'm teaching life skills.
When he's sick, you need medicine. It don't always taste good.
Oh, nah.
But it'll get you better. You need this medicine.
Yeah.
It ain't gonna always taste good. But this is what you need. Men and women, bottom line, we need to have the conversation. Your partner wants to give up control, but only if you know how to drive. This is about being the best you could ever be, whoever you are. I don't care if you're a man, a woman, LGBTQ, space aliens. I'll save anybody. I don't care. I'll teach a hedgehog how to have a threesome.
What do you mean by that?
Look, you don't have to listen to me, but you're wrong.
Listen, I know I'm great. And I know you're thinking, Dante, there's no way I could be like you. But you could be me, you know why?
Because you know who I was? Before I was me, I was you! You!
Man score 202.
Better hear what I've got to say because you won't get it again.
I'm not an alpha male. I'm not a beta male either. I'm just a better man. Better man.
Well, put your happiness first, because if you don't, they won't.
Yup. Yo, what's up, y'all? GYBB, get your balls back. WWDD, what would Dante do? The sexual revolution is being podcasted, and I am excited. This is a special show. Now, I know I've said that 400 times before, but this time I mean it. we got a special guest, but first and foremost, what's going on, Harry? What's going on?
Oh, man, you know me, living a good life. That's how I do, Dante.
I feel you. Looking That's good. Just got back from L.A., huh?
That's right. Back into this.
Little tan.
A little bit of a tan. Back in this swamp. It's worse out here. What the fuck is going
on? Yeah, I know.
Global warming is a hoax.
Yeah, the world is getting ready to end. Let me get a chance to introduce my guest. This dude, I just met him from Australia. He's an artist and a comic, and we've been working together pretty regularly at a couple of the clubs and whatnot, and good, really good dude, funny dude. Give it up for Jason Chatfield, yo. Give it up for Jason.
Thanks
for coming on and doing it, bro. It's just this podcast, little people kind of shy away from it because it's sometimes it's a little intrusive, but we like it that way.
Yeah. Well, you and I have had some pretty honest conversations before.
Yeah. We do. I mean, that's
so how
kinda...
does that happen, Jason? Describe that for people who've never gotten the Dante Nero personal experience.
Yeah. What does that entail? He sits at the back of the room and looks at you for a very long time. And then at some point, he'll lean in and start talking to you, and you'll be like, oh, shit's about to get real. He does a lot of listening. Dante's a good. He's a lot of listening. He looks in the eyes and he listens to every word you say.
Because there's always, you know, there's a reason for that. It's this. There's always a subtext to. There's always that subtext, the inference of what somebody's saying, and a lot of times when they use the words they use, you could tell what they really mean.
Right. Exactly.
And I think a lot of times people are insecure about certain. You know, everybody carries their own insecurities, and so they kind of people use words so that you can't really discuss. Like they don't want to reveal their the weaknesses, you know. Mm-hmm. And so people use words in that. What were we talking about? Comedy or what were we? I forget what we.
It was a pretty wide ranging conversation. We were talking about the fact
that most of it is all of my.
Well, there was a lot of it, but mainly you really you called me on something that I was trying to bullshit you about because I was talking about the fact, you know, when there was a bunch of shows that we were doing together and I was hosting.
Right.
And I let the audience walk all over me. And I was trying to be like, oh, no, I wanted to. But you're like, get the fuck. I know what you don't lie to me. You know, you know what you did.
Yeah.
And it was like it's like I knew. And of course I knew. I've made that mistake a million times before and I was just ashamed of it. And the fact that you were sitting at the back of the room and watched the whole show.
Right.
There's no avoiding it. It was like, well, yeah, that's absolutely what happened. A bunch of people from Bayonne, you know?
Yeah, it was a thing, Harry. It was one of those situations where he was hosting.
Right.
And because The crowd sucked. They were horrible.
Yeah,
that'll happen.
And a lot of times,
great crowd.
Yeah, he was telling them.
Yeah, that'll happen. Yeah, I've seen a lot of people. You're trying to fake it till you make it. You're like trying to hype them. Oh no, you guys are really good. It's like, no, they're not.
They're not.
They're really not. I get what the instinct there is to try to rev them up, and that's fine for the first time. Maybe once or twice, but at some point you got to acknowledge, like, hey, you guys are the shits.
Encouraging bad behavior. Yeah. If you tell them they're good, then they're just going to keep being shit.
Oh, right. Because you've literally reinforced this bad behavior. I mean, not that they needed it in the first place, because they were kind of doing whatever the fuck they wanted to do in the first place. Yeah. But then when you reinforce it, it really gives you a place to know. Nowhere's land, because now you reinforce, and so now if you reprimand them or you go, hey, what the fuck is wrong with you? You look like the idiot because of the fact that you've lied to them.
Yeah, right.
In the first place, which gives you no credibility in the first place.
Exactly. And the you read crowd dynamics and sort of human psychology better than anyone, is that as soon as you do that, there's a ripple effect where they then start pushing it and seeing how far they can take it and see what they can get away with, which fucks every comic who's coming on the show.
Yeah.
Now they're coming into a hostile room, and it's the worst thing you can do as a host. And I did it right off the bat. It was a dreadful mistake.
And the crowd sucked too. People coming into a room, coming for a comedy show, and then coming there with this intention on being disruptive and disrespectful. Yeah. I mean, there's that. But the point is that people, you know, play is going to play, Harry. You know
what I mean? Yeah, but then you got up there and you shot him straight up. Like, you called him on everything, and you knew exactly which pockets to pick. Like, you just sort of swept up you did exactly what I should have done.
Yeah. Well, it's a thing of, you know, what's interesting about that is that you find, moreover, that in all the comedy is life, Harry. Life is comedy.
Well, it's all related.
It is all related.
Also, it's about telling the truth. I realize how conditioned we are to lie. Yeah. Just societally, not even people who are genuinely liars, even people who are quote unquote honest, we're kind of just designed to lie to each other to survive, to make people's lives feel better.
Yeah.
It's strange how we're conditioned that way just in ordinary life.
Yeah.
I'm on the fucking air. How many times are you going to do that? Like, you know, I'm on the air, right? So now you want me to, speaking of lying, instead of acting like my dad's not being a dick by making noise.
Come on, Dad, I'm following my dreams here. What are you doing?
I'm staying at his place till I get my new apartment. But Jesus, Pops, killing me here. Breaking my fucking balls.
Breaking my fucking balls, bro.
Get the fuck out of here.
It's all related. Yeah. And you know, relationships, family relationships, friend relationships, it's all the same thing. If you know, it's funny, it's just something just happened to me. A good friend of mine, he's married, black dude, he's married to a white girl, he's got two little swirly kids, and cute as a dickens, but he moved out to very affluent and white neighborhood. He moved into this house, and so he's got,
you
want to
have a full conversation while I'm broadcasting on the internet? Hold on, guys. Sorry, sorry, Dante. I don't mean, speaking of the truth. All right, there you go. He's gone now. Breaking my balls again.
Breaking my balls.
And now, here's the thing. Normally everybody else would whisper and try to pretend there's nothing. Now I'm conditioned to the point, like Dante goes, what are we doing? Are we going to bullshit here, or are we going to? And then he goes away.
Then he goes away. It works. Mm-hmm. It works every time.
Nobody wants that smoke.
And nobody,
it's the truth, man.
That's gonna be our t-shirt. Nobody wants this smoke.
I'd wear that.
Wants this smoke. He's coming back.
No, now he's trying to break my balls by going, do you want me to open the garage door for fresh air? He's being a dick. Now he's being funny.
Yeah, which, doing
is,
a little drum
which is kind of funny. Just you think that's a legitimate suggestion. You're asking me legitimately if I want to open the garage door in the middle of the podcast while I'm broadcasting to get fresh air while it's raining.
Brilliant.
Your whole backdrop.
Yeah.
just your whole backdrop the whole disappears.
You want here? Open the garage door open for it. A second. Let's open the garage door and see if this is. Let's see if this is better, Pops. See if this is better. If this is a better thing to do. There we go. Is that a better?
That's way better.
It's way better.
Now I can't hear anything. Now it's 80 degrees instead of being 70 in here. It's nice and fucking 80 degrees humidity. It's perfect. Hit the button on your way out. Thank you.
Beautiful.
let me teach you a little something.
I love that.
Years I've been trying to get Harry to do that.
Yeah.
That right there.
Uh-huh.
At least 8 years I've been
eight years of training to get him.
Look, stop letting other people make you feel uncomfortable.
That's a breakthrough,
if
Harry.
It is. If you're uncomfortable, I'm making everybody else. Everybody's gonna be uncomfortable. We are all gonna sit in this shit together. You like it like this? Okay. That's good. I always think about that.
Let's make it uncomfortable. I'm not gonna be the only one who's uncomfortable.
I don't want to be a guy. I don't want to make trouble. Okay, I'm making all the trouble. All the trouble. I was saying. So my buddy, he lives in this very affluent white neighborhood, and he lives next to a Karen. Right.
Mm-hmm.
First week he moves in, this woman has she's got a couple of illegal domestics. They're cleaning the leaves, pile of leaves that's been there, and they're taking the leaves and shoveling it and throwing it over his fence, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just shoveling it over on his side of the fence. Just insane. So he comes down, what the fuck is this? And she goes, you don't tell me what to do. This is my problem. Yeah, but you're shoveling shit on my own fence. Then, so what he does is he had another situation. I don't know what she called the cops on him because he was on his steps, right? Who's this black dude on the steps? Second event, third event, he's getting a fence put up now. He wants a higher fence. So they're putting the fence up and she comes out and she goes, hey, how are you, neighbor? And he goes, you know, because he's kind of under my tutelage. He goes, you want me to act like you didn't call the cops on me and we haven't had two incidents and we're neighbors? Fuck you. So she comes and walks on his property and she goes, I don't know. You're crazy. You seem very hostile. I should call the cops. He goes, you know what? Forget it. I'm going to call the cops. So he calls the cops. Naturally, the cops come out. One of the cops goes in her house and I guess they had tea or something. He called the cops on her. They had tea. The other one was, he said, so what happened here? The guy goes, what happened? He goes, well, what happened was he starts telling her the leave story. And he goes, listen, speed it up. So you're going, so now he goes, listen, then his wife comes out. So he's got a nice white wife and some little brown kids. So he goes, oh, yeah, it's your family. So the guy kind of relaxed because he's a big black dude too. Guy gets, the cop starts saying, he goes, you know, I mean, sometimes you just got to ignore your neighbors, this, that. So he tells me this story and the guy says, so she has a pool. And in the pool, you have to have a fence around your pool, around your property. You can't. It's illegal. It's also a $10,000 fine if you don't have it. Right. And so he goes, yeah, you watch and see. This is what the cop told him. He goes, you watch and see. The next time she fucks with me, I'm going to put a complaint in about her fence. And I go, put in the complaint. Like if you fuck with me. I tell everybody, if you make me as an enemy, it's all on the table.
Yeah.
Murder, assault, bombs, arson, slander. I'm snitching. I'm calling the IRS. I'm calling the Child Protective Service. I'm calling PETA because you didn't change your cat litter too often. I'm calling. You want the smoke? You're gonna get all the smoke. So he's like, oh, the next time I go, next time she's gonna call the cops on you, and you're gonna get tased five times, and your daughter's gonna watch you get cuffed and pulled over because you waiting for the next time.
Mm-hmm.
The thing is, you gotta understand. You always gotta understand that. People show you who they are, believe them. So when you started the show, they were already out of control. You got to go, look, here's the fucking deal. This is not how we do things. If you're going to act like this, you got to get the fuck out. Mm-hmm. Oh, no joke. No. Let's pander. You're going to have to get the fuck out. Mm. This way, and you say it out loud, and you make them agree to it. Mm. I will not act in this way, because you expand the social contract. Now, you can't say you didn't know. You can't say you didn't understand. So now when you get punched in the mouth, you know why you got punched in the mouth. It's all clear. But if you go with this, well, they kind of knew, or they should know better. Or
right. No one, don't assume anyone knows better, ever.
No. Common sense ain't common. If it was, everybody would know about it. You know, they would know.
Yeah. Average intelligence is nothing to crawl about.
No. Don't expect average common sense and average intelligence. And you find more over than not.
Yeah.
Well, I will find this. There's a lot of shady people do not fuck with me. Like, if their intention is to be shady, they would rather just not. Like, they'll find somebody else to scam, because if I catch you scamming me, right now, you get all the smoke.
The price is gonna be high.
The payback is gonna be high. This is not a nickel slots. $500 blackjack tables. Every time you put a hand up, that's what it's gonna cost you. It's gonna hurt. So
what kind of scam artist is seeing you as a mark?
Oh,
There's no way.
Oh,
really?
Are you kidding me?
They see you and they go, oh, here's someone I want to fuck with.
Because they think they're smarter than you.
Oh, my God.
Because they also believe that people are not going to speak up. They believe that people don't want to smoke. They're accustomed to getting over. That somehow they just got it all figured out and you're not going to see it. I go, you know, I mean, you got to really, it's unfortunate that you have to act that way. But Mike, I'm a really kind dude. I'm kind to a fault at times. Yeah. But when I turn on you, right, I'm as evil as I am kind. And I'm really, really kind. So I get that. I mean, Harry's been around me when it's uncomfortable. I'm just like, I'll do anything. I'll do anything to help anybody. But is this what we doing? Okay. Fair enough. You know,
like extreme about it, you know, in the sense of like, you know, you give people a chance and opportunity. People make mistakes. Oh, yeah. You're not a tyrant about it. But when it's clear that somebody is not respecting your space or time, then it becomes a problem.
Oh, yeah. We going on. And that's kind of the thing. And you find that I find that is the key to attraction, like even male female attraction, because it's if you don't like yourself enough to put your happiness first, then you're saying to the other counterpart, the comedy audience, mm-hmm. bookers, friends, family, right. You're saying, I'm not worth the respect that I want. I'm willing to put up with whatever you're willing to get. And they're going, you know, message received.
Right.
Now
that's exactly right. Yeah. They're like you said, you know, tell people who you are and they'll, you know, and believe them. But if people want to, they will go to such lengths to avoid just an awkward, not even pain.
Yeah.
It's not even a front to pain. It's those little socially awkward things that they'll play in their head later.
Yeah.
Oh boy, that was uncomfortable for 45 seconds.
Yeah.
Instead, they'll subject themselves to weeks and weeks of inconvenience.
Torment.
Just because they didn't want to hurt someone's feelings, because they didn't want to feel awkward.
I'll hurt your feelings. I will hurt your feelings. I will.
There's another shirt that I would wear. I will
hurt your feelings. And then, you know, and if I'm wrong and my assessment is incorrect, I'll also apologize. Dog, this is what I thought. I thought this. It was, you know, you could, and you're not going to go.
There was a situation there was a comic who you were having a conversation with somebody and the comic stepped in and you were having a problem with the person you were talking to.
Right.
So you ended up kind of like snapping on this comic for interrupting. And then later you got the number. You asked me for the number. I don't want to give the name out.
Oh, yeah.
Number. So that you could go, hey, listen, just so you know, that wasn't about you. I didn't want, you know, I felt funny about that, blah, blah, blah. And you squashed it and they felt good about it.
Yeah.
So it's not like, you know, it's okay to apologize if you feel like you've done something wrong.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people think an apology is, you know, everything is forced apologies. It is okay to apologize when you go, hey,
well, yeah, I apologize all the time.
I was off on that. My bad.
Yeah, there's that difference between the disingenuous apology, which is trying to get yourself out of trouble, versus actually feeling contrition and being, you know, oh man, that sucks. I want to tell that guy I'm sorry. You know, I was a dick. You know.
Now, to be honest, even the dude that was kind of overstepping, he definitely was not reading the room. Clearly, we were having a private conversation, and he was like, oh, blah, 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 blah. And I was like, dog, you got to go.
Right. A socially retarded comedian? Really? Whoa.
And I go, and he goes, oh, my bad. And I go, you know, look, I'm not, you know, you see two people, you guys busy, if it's cool, I would say that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not a person who would overstep. And I think this is an interesting thing about, so we talk about the principles of the podcast is authenticity, credibility, and empathy. Mm-hmm. You got to have the empathy also to know what people are going through. Like, to the same token, and we talk about, you know, like an unruly audience. Mm-hmm. If you haven't given them the parameters from which to behave,
right,
then it's your fault.
Yep.
Because 100%. Maybe if you stopped and said, listen, maybe this is the first comedy show they've been to.
Exactly.
Maybe they don't understand the ethics. So let me explain. You know, I say this all the time. Somebody steps on your foot, you got to go, ouch. Mm-hmm. Yo, you stepped on my foot. This way it gives you an opportunity to go, oh man, I apologize. I didn't even see there. I'm sorry. You okay? And then I go, yeah, I'm fine. And just, you know, I appreciate you acknowledging it, you know? Right. Whereas if you sit, I used to argue with Harry all the time, like early on when we first started hanging out, he'd be like, you know, I don't want to be an asshole. I don't want to. I was like, you couldn't be an asshole if you wanted to. You don't even have it in you to be an asshole. Now, his dad, on the other hand, he could be an asshole.
My dad is easy. It comes easy, naturally.
I mean, it's just not like, it's like breathing. It's like breathing. But the funny thing is, Harry would get angry. And then we shut the fuck up. Stop it. No, just like,
let's make it awkward for everybody.
See, yeah, okay.
Don't break my balls.
Because Harry would still be going through back and forth with his father right now. Mm-hmm. Am I lying?
I think, it would definitely have been a more of a whisper interaction and him not getting it and then being confused and not understand. And just stop it. Go away. I love you to death, but go away. He can't help it. I don't know what his deal is, but he can't help it.
Yeah,
it doesn't matter what his deal is.
And it works for everything. You got a girl?
Yeah.
You got a girlfriend? Yeah. How long?
I've got a wife. We've been together.
Cool.
Yeah, we've been together 12 years, married, Jesus, eight.
All right. Sorry.
So we're very honest with you. You were together 12, married 8?
Yeah, we met. She used to be a comic. We met at a comedy festival, Melbourne International Comedy Festival, and then she went off and did Edinburgh and all that stuff. She was way more successful than me when we met, and she's smart. She stopped doing comedy.
What made her stop?
You know, it was she was a part of a group, like a comedy group with other girls,
like a sketch or
kind of more musical comedy, more like a musical comedy group. And so she played piano and sang and wrote, and when the other girls kind of broke off, you know, and did their own thing, she was like, oh, fuck it, I'm not gonna go solo. She tried going solo for 3 or 4 years, but she's like, it's not for me, I prefer to be in an ensemble. So she understands comedy in a way that most partners probably don't, because she did it already, and so understands my, you know, my obsession with it and what going out and working means. And you know, she's a lot more understanding and that way. And also I can't bullshit her, because every she knows the truth of what it is to work as a comic. So I'm very honest with her. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's interesting. Because we actually had Gianmarco on.
Love that guy.
And Gianmarco was talking, but his girl is like an agent or something. Mm-hmm. It's like a high power agent. And he was saying to me that, you know, she knows the business, but yet and still, even though she knows his business, they still go at it about the time and this and that and the other. Mm-hmm. And I was like, there is a, I really thought that was interesting, is that even though she knows she knows the routine, the same complaints are there. Like, what about the time? What about this? What about, you know, when you come on, we want to go see the movie. We want to go to the movies. And what's it? And he's always trying to, you know, he's a good dude. Like, he's a really good
dude. He's a great dude. Yeah. Really. And good. And he's going to blow up as well. I mean, as if he hasn't already, he's one of these really good, hardworking and honest guys.
Yeah. It's rare. But the thing is, I said to him then, I said, you cannot treat comedy like it's your side bitch. Mm-hmm. You can't like it's a side bitch that you're sneaking around to do. Comedy's gotta be your main chick. Right. And your wife has to understand that the parameters of that, and even if she's done it, what you find is still, I guess what I'm asking is, does she still have the same complaints even though she knows what the parameters of being a comic is? And, well, and is it a little bit different because she was ensemble and you're solo?
Yeah, well, that's it. I mean, during the time that we were seeing each other initially, when we were dating, I was doing I had already been doing stand-up for about maybe 4 or 5 years. Uh-huh. And on the side, I was also doing like a bit of improv with this group, because I wanted to have that as a skill that I could build on for stand-up, really. And so she saw both of those worlds. She saw like the cultish weird improv scene, and then she saw the lone wolf stand-up comic scene, you know, doing the road and doing festivals and that sort of stuff. And so when we moved to New York, I threw out 7 years worth of material and started again. And I was going out doing 5 or 6 shows a night at one point, where she's like, geez, these are some long late nights you're doing. And I'm like, that's what it takes. That's the job. Like, and so we had that it was a pretty frank conversation. And it was, well, you don't move halfway across the world and then just half-ass it, you know.
Right.
So, you know, we had that conversation, and she wanted to be a musician. So I was like, all right, well, you know, if you're going to go out gigging as well, and you're going to be doing sets and playing at restaurants and playing wherever you can get a spot, then you're going to be out late as well. And sure enough, for about the first 4 years we were here, she was playing like cigar lounges and bars and hotels, restaurants, music venues. So all of a sudden, she was seeing the same kind of same kind of thing. She was making more than me than I was making doing spots, but she saw it. And then the only difference was then I started doing the road, and that's something that she just never did as a musician. So she never understood kind of the road and what that kind of meant. So that was one thing that, you know, I had to kind of explain, like, not explain, but like, be super honest and be like, all right, well, this is what it is. And here's the money, and here's the, you know, I'm going to be away, and it's just part of that job. But yeah, it's so weird, because when she was with a group of girls, they would all like, they toured, they did all kinds of shows and festivals and private gigs. And the stories from the road from them were crazy. But then New York is a different thing. America is a different thing. She never did that comedy stuff here in the U.S.
The stories were different. In what way? Mm-hmm. In what way?
Well, so like in the U.K. and in Australia, you really have, and you've probably spoken to other comics who do this, like, but like the festival circuit versus the road is that the festival, you're doing 25 to 30 shows across a month. Like every night you're on stage for an hour. And you get good that way. I mean, you better get good that way.
Right.
But then that means every single night after the show, you're probably out. You're hanging out with other comics, which, you know, that's its own bag of cats. And, you know, the attitude is that it's such an incestuous kind of industry, and everyone's fucking each other and everyone's bullshitting each other about what they got and how they got that and who's got representation and who's doing this and what venue they got and time slot and all that shit. And all of that politics is like festival comic politics. And then you have the road, which is really, different.
You show up and go do your gig, and you're in a strip mall. Exactly. You're in a hotel. You're in a
Funny bone. Yeah, exactly. You're staying in a shitty hotel. It's a
lot more solemn and depressing, too. There's that camaraderie hanging out with other comedians and other people in your industry.
Yeah, the first time I'd hear my voice is when I'm just about to go up. Like, for the day, I'm mute all day, and then all of a sudden. Whereas they're talking throughout, they're losing their voice. They're having to have, like, you know, honey and lemon tea because they're all hanging out, the drink and the smoke, and they're bullshitting each other every night. And then, it's on the road. Now,
did she think that was the same, that she just assumed that your hangout was the same way? And then...
Yeah.
And so was she insecure about that or no? What was
I think part of it was that I was a little older than the other people I was performing with and doing. Because I came in, I moved here when I was like 29, 30. Mm-hmm. So the other guys that I was getting up with and guys and girls were in their 20s, you know. And and she'd you know, come to shows sometimes and come to, you know, where I was performing and sort of see some of the women and go and see, you know, oh, they seem to be pretty, you know, they're in their 20s. They're fucking around, you know. So there was kind of a sense of like she wanted to make sure that, you know, I was here to work. I'm not here to fucking, you know, fuck around. And and my dad cheated on my mom. So I've got like a hang up about cheating in my head already. I'm pre-wired to sort of be a bit funny about it. And I think it took a while. It took genuinely like a few years before she was like, all right, I trust you. But she had that thing because she came from that festival thing. I was like, it's not really like that.
Yeah, but then let me ask you this. When she was doing it, was she running around? When she was with you, was she running around sucking dicks and fucking people the whole time?
No, but guys were trying to fuck her.
But because there was a certain commitment or whatever, and she was committed to it, she didn't. You weren't running around going, "Oh, well, who are you fucking?" And this, that. Yeah, you know what I mean, do you understand what I'm saying? My point is, fuck you. Like, you did this, was okay, and somehow morally, I have the moral fiber to be in the midst of this, and you should trust me, and then you don't have the moral fiber to be in the midst of this, and I don't trust you, so I gotta check to see, because the reality is the insecurity has nothing to do with me, it has to do with you.
That's right,
You think you're not good enough. Mm-hmm. You think you're not good enough to be... so that you're enough.
Yeah.
And so now it's this 20-year-old girl who kind of sees me. I see myself as not as hot as her or not as valuable as her. Or she thinks that you would think that, which is still that's your problem.
Right.
Like, I say this all the time. You can't, if you're not cheating already. Right. And you're getting accused of cheating and you're trying, you know, you have this jealousy. You can't not cheat more. If you're already not cheating, you can't go.
You're getting all of the shit without any other benefit.
Right. Like it's like, don't even, you better not even talk to me about that. But I think what's happening is, so there's an honesty that I think is not, that there's an honesty that I think that a lot of times women will a dishonesty, you know, this mistrust of you simply because you're supposed to be this kind of guy or you're a guy. And then there's not this. And and meantime, your friends are fucking and hanging out. I mean, you know that this world, because you're watching your friends hook up with guys and this and that. And now because of your fucking shitty friends and because of maybe what you did or what you wanted to do, now all of a sudden that's bad.
I think the guys who were trying to fuck her as well during the festival scene and stuff like that, I did hear some stories that were like, Jesus, these guys really went a little far a few times.
What do you mean? Give me an example.
Like getting a little stalky and like, you know, following her home, going, hey, where are you staying? Hey, and then like hanging out outside a window and stuff like that. And I was like, yeah, that's a bit much. That to me, that's getting to be a little bit more than just
trying to fuck. And she thought these 20-year-old girls were hanging out outside your window and following you home.
Well, I think she saw what guys were like in comedy. And she's like, yeah, you could be encouraged by a similar group of guys to just
So could you. You could be encouraged.
Yeah.
All you have to do is submit. You don't even have to be encouraged. All you got to do is just whisper out the window, hey, want to come up? You know, the guy sitting in the bushes. It's real easy. He's right there.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's this.
You can set your own boundaries no matter what it is.
Yeah.
You can tolerate whatever you want to tolerate or don't want to tolerate. You know, you can go, listen, I don't want to hear, I'm not cheating on you. I don't ever want to hear about it again.
Yeah. I wish I had.
Again. Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
It takes time to get there. It took me a long time to get there, but you can do that. You can go, listen, I haven't cheated on you. I don't ever want to hear it again. And if it comes up again, we're done. That's it. And then if it comes up again, you go, what did I say?
I don't even go, what did I say?
Yeah. Yeah. Fair enough.
You come home and I'm packing my shit.
You're wrong. I mean, it takes time to learn that, Jason. So I'm not, it's not a criticism because I hate being like, this is what you should have done, bro. You know, it's not that.
It is that though. It's me not being ballsy enough to go, I'm not cheating on you. I didn't ever want you to accuse me of that again. Cause like I said, I've already got a hang up about it in my brain. So to then be like having to answer for it, I did used to get pretty like, hey, what the fuck? I didn't do anything. There was a definite sense of like, because I had friends in comedy who I did know who would kind of fuck around. And if they had a partner, and I was like, I don't know, I'm not going to. I always felt a bit weird about it. So then to like cop it, I was like I said, in the early years of the relationship,
leave your righteous bullshit alone. You don't know what that man is going through.
I have no idea what he's. Yeah,
his cunt of a wife is running him through. Just you're sitting up and you're judging him because he's fucking has.
No, it's that I didn't want to have to keep his secret. That's what that was. I didn't want
to. You don't have to do that either.
Right. No, well, like if we're out and his partner's out there and I'm like looking at her and they have, I'm like, hey, yeah, that's good to see you.
Like, what do you mean? If she's,
you don't want to have to look her in the eyes knowing that her man's fucking around.
Right. I don't want to have to keep someone else's secret.
Yeah, I'm not keeping nobody's secret. I'm just like,
Okay. So here's a hypothetical for you. Then so you're out with a buddy of yours and you're with both your partners and you know, he's been fucking around on her.
Right.
Do you, if she brings it up at some point, she's like, oh yeah, you boys, you know, you're fucking whatever. And then jokes about, oh, he's fucking around on me, whatever. Would you then go, yeah, he is. So
no,
like, would you say,
I go, I don't know. Now, if she asks me,
is she asking
you directly or is it, she just
jokingly like, oh, he's probably fucking around me. Right. Ooh,
yeah. I go, if you think he's fucking around me, you probably should leave. And if anybody would know if he's fucking around, he would know. Right. And it's like, because let's be honest, what she's doing is unfair to you.
Yeah, that's true.
This was the person's partner, the wife or whatever.
Yeah, it's putting it on me to try and get me to reveal something. Yeah, so
you got a shitty relationship. You have no trust element in your relationship, and now somehow I'm caught up in your shit. And then I get you interrogating me.
Break my balls?
You want to break my balls? You want to break my balls?
You want to break my balls?
I tell you what, if he is, I would go. If he's cheating on you, you probably deserve it. That's what I go. Then you go. Then she goes, maybe I shouldn't ask this dude.
I don't ask this dude no questions. I don't want to ask him for directions.
Unless you want the answer.
I don't
want to
ask him where the cereal is. I don't want to ask him nothing.
Oh, so you're saying he is? I go, I'm not his balls or his dick. If you think there's a problem, then you need to speak to him. And if you're questioning this, I would say if you're questioning this, then you guys got problems way beyond what I know and what I don't know. You need to deal with that. Just keep me the fuck out of it. Either we're friends or we're not friends. And we could not be friends. We could pay this check right now and never talk to each other again. That's fine.
You're happy doing that. You're happy just cutting it off.
I'm so happy because let's be honest. How often in your life do you really have people that bring value to your life.
Like, very rarely.
Even the people that you hang out, friends, family, associates.
At best, they're not stealing value from you, but they ain't really giving value to you.
Ain't nobody bringing, nobody's lifting you up, you know? So I feel like, so here's a primary example. We haven't known each other that long, and we've worked together and so on and so forth, but I saw what was going on in the with you hosting and them taking advantage of you and stuff. Mm-hmm. And so I go, come here, let me help you.
You try to educate him.
You need to understand this. No, I didn't shit on him. I didn't think
he's a funny
dude. He's a good dude. You need to see, here's something that I know that I found to be true. You could take it, you don't take it, whatever, whatever. But here, I'm gonna help you. Mm-hmm. Now, even in the context of let's be honest, even in the context of yours and my friendship right now, you ain't do shit for me. Yeah. I've already helped you. I've already given you knowledge you didn't have.
Yeah.
And so I bring value to your life in a sense. Even if I don't do anything else from this point on, you owe me. I'm not saying you owe me, but
is that like, what this is about?
Yeah, this was the whole show is about. But I also am giving, like I'm giving. So this is an interesting thing. And people give and they feel slighted because they don't give back. They don't get back. Mm-hmm. So they've invested certain things. I have a philosophy. I say never give more than you can give without not receiving anything in return.
That's fair.
So for instance, I use this analogy all the time. If I see a homeless dude, he asks me for change and I give him a dollar. If he uses the dollar for drugs or for get Wild Irish white wine or whatever the fuck he uses it for, a sandwich or a beer, whatever he does, probably $2 or $3, whatever it is. But what he uses it for, he uses it. Now, if I take that homeless dude, bring him into my house, shower him, clean him up, get him a suit. Mm-hmm. I work on his resume. I put his resume out. We get an interview for a job and then he doesn't show up for the job. I'm punching that dude in the head because I've given so much that at the very least, the return on that should be your appreciation of how far I've gone.
Sure.
But I'm also, if I bring you in and I do all of this, I'm going to say, listen, I will help you, but you need to understand right out the back, this is what I expect back. So it's clear. So we, again, this is what I mean by expanding the social contract. We have a verbal declaration of what I expect. You understand. So when you move forward, you know what's expected of you.
Right.
You're giving me your word. The minute you don't keep your word, now we're enemies. Right. Now we have a problem.
Right.
So My point being is that you, if you, when you bring value to people's like, so it's very rare that I'm in a situation where, because I approach life with the generosity of bringing value to people's lives, it's very rare that I ever get people that even attempt to give me the value back that I give.
Yeah.
So cutting you off, all that means is that I don't got to give you nothing else.
Mm-hmm.
Like all that means is that whatever you were going to get just by being in my presence, being around me.
Right.
I'm not mad. I just take your access pass.
Yeah.
I'll take your season tickets.
Yeah. Season tickets to Dante.
And then you do it on your own now.
This is like a thing, you know, that book Influence, the Robert Cialdini book Influence about the rule of reciprocity and all that sort of stuff. Like,
I've heard it, but I don't know. Right.
It's kind of the idea is that we're kind of pre-wired to reciprocate kindness and things like that, which is why, you know, when someone sends you a thing and it's like, oh, it's got a free thing, you're more likely to buy from them if they gave you something for free first. Mm-hmm. That whole idea, if someone goes against that, someone's generous to them and they're nice to them and they give them time and advice and energy, and then they give nothing back, that's a certain psychology. That's a certain kind of psychology of a person that is just, it's in there, and it's not that it's not changeable. It's just that's the kind of person they are.
Right, right. That's their constitution. Well, I disagree.
That's their ethos.
I see that constantly.
Oh,
I
mean, it's Harry, everywhere now.
Harry will tell you that dudes that I've, you know, dragged out of the gutter, going right. through breakups and stuff.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Never
yeah.
even
yeah.
looked back for a thank you. In fact, have told stories mm-hmm. about the incident and then omitted me from the story.
Wow.
So
they didn't even give you credit.
No, not even.
Let alone pay you back. They didn't even give you credit for the thing in the first place.
No. I'm not looking for the payback either. I just the acknowledgement.
But it does let you know about the person. And now you know
you're not doing it
about the person.
Yeah.
Like, you're not doing it because you want something. Like, necessarily, you're not doing it because you want something back. You're doing it because you're a good person, because you're generous. But then the thing, it's more respect, right? It's more, it's showing you disrespect if you don't return the favor, or if you at least don't respond in kind. And this is the reason I do this. It's my wife is sick of me talking about it. I do a friend audit all the time. Every year or two, I see relationships that are all take. And all give, you know, and I'm like, and I don't even care. I excise them from my life. I just cut them out.
Now, do you tell them?
Oh, they figure it out. No, sometimes I tell them, And other times, it's pretty amazing actually. And moving countries is a great excuse to do it in a big way. Cause you accumulate people in your life that end up becoming these sort of,
Like black holes.
Exactly. They're just always asking for things. They're always borrowing. It's always one way. And then as soon as you, if you ever ask them for anything, they'll be like, oh man, I'd love to, but I got to do another thing. Like, they would never reciprocate. Right. And I was a real people pleaser for a long, long time, a lot of my life. And I think, you know, it goes way back to when I was a kid, you know, and it's also a cultural thing in Australia. A lot of Australians and British people are people pleasers. They'd rather say yes and then fuck themselves than say no and suffer that awkwardness. So I would often, you know, just collect these people who I just couldn't say no to. Cause I was,
now, is that a cultural thing just because of manners? What is it, like, manners wise or what do you think culturally? Yeah.
I think largely it's too awkward to be honest with people. And I don't know, it's different here. I think, especially in New York, but I think it's different in different parts of America too. There are certainly parts of America that are very polite and very, you know, very, you know, clean.
Well, my wife is from England. And so,
right.
And so she often talks about the right thing to do. She doesn't say that. She's not that, but it's like the right. It's this kind of idea that you're supposed to act, you know, in a certain way.
Exactly. It is cultural. In that sense, it is cultural. And Australia is very much like the UK because, you know, we're all the same bag of shit.
But Harry, do you find that to be, I mean, wondering what your experience is. Would you find that to be the case in New York, in the States? I mean, I kind of think it's the same thing. I mean, always find people that, I mean, we've
not
come
to the English, not to the English and Australian degree. They're on another level of like never letting your emotions out at all.
Yeah, but Harry, you were that guy who was like the people, I don't want to be a dick.
People pleaser.
How many times have we helped guys who have said, well, you know, I don't want to be a dick. I mean, what do you call them?
Those are the guys who suffer the most, because those are the type of guys like myself who had too polite was also too scared and too timid at the same time.
So it just wasn't polite. It was fear as well.
It was fear as well. That's also where the politeness comes from.
Jason, you think it's the same thing? Is it also fear?
I think it is. I definitely think it's fear that drives it. It's definitely fear. It's a deep-seated fear that you're going to be the asshole. For some reason, there's nothing worse than someone thinking ill of you.
Here's the crazy thing, because that's the same thing that Harry said to me years ago before he would open up the garage door.
Let's do it then. Let's see how this works out. Let's see how this fucking works. Isn't this great? It's nice and humid in here now instead of being nice and cool. It's loud as fuck. There's a bright light coming in, so nobody can see me. Nobody can hear me. I'm all sweaty. Isn't it great?
All right. So to answer your question about this, because there is I've lived here 7 years now. I've lived in Manhattan, and I've got when I first moved here, I was still very much like I was in Australia. I was very apologetic to the point where And ask any Australian or British person this, when someone comes over and asks them what they'd like to order, like for food, they'll go, oh, yeah, sorry, can I just get a coffee? And sorry, do you have the, they'll say sorry without even realizing they're saying sorry. Mm-hmm. And they'll do it several times throughout the conversation. Sorry, can I just, and so I lost that over time just by being direct, by being in New York, you don't have fucking time to fuck around. You just like, you tell them, yeah, I'll get two coffees and a this, you know, you just say what you want. Mm-hmm. And you're not being rude, you're being direct. Right. So for the first time ever, my sister came over. So the first time in the 7 years I've lived here, my sister came over. She had a real go at me because she was like, you're so fucking rude now. And I'm like, I'm not rude. I'm direct. I'm not afraid to say no to people. Like, but someone will come up and ask for change or for money. And if I don't have money, I'm going to go, sorry, man, no. She's like, how can you say? I'm like, because I don't have money. I'm not going to fucking lie. Go, oh, I'm so sorry. Oh, I wish I could. Do you have Venmo? Like, I'm not going to fucking lie. I'm just going to say no and then move on with my fucking day. And so there's so much time that is wasted just by the fear that comes from not wanting to be disliked. You know, if you're trying to get everyone to like you, that's, God, what a fucking life to live.
Yeah, it's also a situation where and people will see that and then take advantage of. Like, I had this homeless dude asked me for money. I was going to one of this deli and I gave him some money, right? Mm-hmm. And then I ate breakfast there, but I was hungry, so I went back for lunch. Mm-hmm. So to him, I guess everything is just it's just a blur of him begging.
He might not have remembered you.
And he didn't he didn't remember me. Right. Which is, come on, dog. Really? Come on. You know?
I had a guy like that in my bodega every single day. He never remembered if I gave him money or not. He just go, ah, fuck you.
Right. So he goes, yo, can I? I go, yo, you don't. I just gave you money this morning. Oh, my bad. I go, so now I'm supposed to feed you every fucking time you, yo. And so he's like, oh, I'm sorry, yo, get the fuck away from me. And then he's like, okay. I go, but think about it is that.
Well, that's why you're never going to be on Comic Relief, Dante.
Probably not. It's never going to happen.
There is one thing I'll wrap up saying this is that I definitely had to learn that as a skill. That didn't come naturally to me. Saying no to people is the most foreign thing in the world to me. That was coming from Australia, coming from a place
that... Is that an Australian thing or is it a family thing?
I think it's British, Australian, I think South Africans. It's a very like polite societal cultural thing.
Yeah, unless they're colonizing people and stealing their shit. Then it's fine.
Excuse me, do you mind?
Do you mind? Can I take you home?
Yeah, they don't mind being rude for centuries. But they just... Yeah,
it's just in the immediate. Systemically, they're fine. Yeah. But just in the immediate. So is that your coffee? Like, fuck you.
But that's why, like, I would end up with way too much work than I could do because I said yes to a bunch of shit that friends or, you know, people would say, hey, do you think you could just quickly do this for me? Can you do this for me? And then I had this giant list of things to do and no time to do it because I didn't know how to say no to anyone.
Motherfuckers would ask me, you know, to move a couch. I'd be like, nah, dog, I ain't moving a couch. And they'd be like, well, you know, you got a van, and I had a Tahoe. It's like, you got a Tahoe. I go, yeah, my leather seats is not to carry your couch, dog. I didn't get leather interior so you could gash my fucking leather seats up. Right. And he's like, oh, well, I just thought we were friends. I'm like, yeah, we ain't, nah. No, we ain't that good. Nah, we're not. So now it's clear. Mm-hmm. Go ask somebody else. What the fuck? Now, but if you go, they're gonna come back. They'll run around again. That dude at the bodega, he don't ask me for money no more. In fact, when he sees he remembers me now. Mm-hmm. He goes the other way. He sees me and he'll make eye contact. Then he goes and looks for cigarette butts. So
because you were honest with him, you didn't lie to him.
Yeah, and the thing is, I had given him money. Like, I probably gave him a fiver too. Like, so he could get it was like he could get a whole breakfast. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then he was just like, "Yeah, let me hit this motherfucker again." And I'm like, "Oh yeah, we're gonna get there. Yo, let's." Can we shut this? Can you hang out? Because we're going to do a little extra for the Patreon. Can you hang out for a little
while? Absolutely. Yeah, right.
Can you plug anything you want to plug? Any shows? Any social media?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, just jasonchatfield.com is my comedy and my art and everything. There is one thing that I think your listeners would like that I do every November, and it's called November. It's no-vember.net, and it's 30 days of learning to say no to shit. Basically, really? I teach you every day how to build that skill of not being a fucking people pleaser. It's stuff I learned over, you know, 2 decades, and I kind of distill it into 30 days. So no-vember.net.
That's like sober September and no November.
Exactly. Yeah.
What's dry your July. Everything is your social media? What are those? Can you tell me those?
Yeah, that's all. That's all at jasonchatfield.com. I have like Jason Chatfield Comedian is my Facebook group for comedy. So
you also do art too? Yes.
I'm a cartoonist. I do cartoons for the New Yorker magazine and Mad and stuff like that. Yeah.
Dope. I gotta show you a cartoon. You gotta tell me who did it. There was this bouncer on the New Yorker magazine that fucking everybody sent it to me because it looks like me.
Probably. A lot of cartoonists go to comedy shows all the time. They love comedy. So they probably saw you and went, perfect. I'm going to draw that guy.
Harry, talk to me.
You go all my stuff at Harry Terjanian. That is my all my social media handles. And join us over at Patreon. We're gonna be answering some listener mail actually from the cool. Patreon, our patrons. So come check us out there, and also check out the YouTube channel, Manschool 202 on YouTube.
Also, I want to shout out Andre. We fucked up today. This was kind of like we ran a little crazy with the time we were. Andre's been writing and stuff like that, and we forgot to reach out to him. So I want to shout out his everything, all his social medias, Andre D. Thompson. Check him out. I love that dude, and I didn't want to, you know, would never leave him out on purpose. Everything with me, Dante Nero, the Dante Nero on Instagram, Dante Nero. Check out my YouTube page. I'm starting to put up Dante Nero. I don't know what my fucking thing is, but you know, if you Google me, you'll find me. I'm putting up comedy stuff and whatnot. GYBB, get your balls back. WWDD, what would Dante do to sexual revolution being podcasted? Yo, I love y'all. Also, don't forget the one-on-one consultations. You can hit me at DanteNero.com. Click on consult. And if you need me to tell you how to handle your life, I do that. You can book some time with me. We are out. We're going to go to the Patreon. Make sure y'all sign up for the Patreon and get with us on that as well. We are out. Manschool 202 is created by Dante Nero, hosted by Dante Nero, with Harry Terjanian and Andre D. Thompson, produced by Harry Terjanian, executive producers Matt Kleinschmidt, Harry Terjanian, and Dante Nero.